Hello, and welcome to another FAQ Monday. I am your host, Fluff. If you have a question, feel free to leave them on down below or go on over to my Ask FM account thing. We'll get you squared away. I kind of do need questions in all seriousness. So if you could leave a comment or, you know, do that, that'd be cool. First question. How you feeling, dude? Doing okay? I'm doing all right. I've been off, by the time you guys see this, I will have been off pain meds for about a week. And before that week, I was in an extreme amount of pain. And, you know, pain meds kind of make you a zombie, and that never feels any good, and you don't want to eat, so I didn't eat. Yeah, that sucked. But I am doing much better. I'm still supposed to technically be bedridden. Not bedridden, but, you know, I'm supposed to be really taking it easy. But honestly, I'm so bored and out of my mind with just nothing to do that I'm just gonna get back in the saddle again. Just, it's time to go back to work, because a week of playing Mario Kart on a Nintendo Switch is enough. That's enough. It was fun, but it's enough. It's time to get back to work. There's questions to be answered. So yeah, here I am, but thanks for asking. Is it possible to use home theater speakers and a receiver as monitors? I'm trying to set up a little home recording rig, but on a very low budget. Honestly, no. I mean, if you're trying to do any kind of audio work, home theater speakers are not what you want to use, because home theater speakers are designed to sound real, real nice and flattering and make the explosions in the movie sound huge and lots of lows and et cetera, et cetera. Whereas studio monitors are very flat and they're supposed to be unflattering so you can hear the problem areas, so you can correct them, and so they can sound good on things like home stereo systems and cars and things like that. So if I were you, for now, I would just buy a set of decent headphones, you know, like Sennheiser or Beyerdynamic DT770s, something like that. I would just mix on some headphones for now until you can get some actual monitors. But monitors aren't that crazy. I mean, you know, some LSR 305s from JBL are like $150 a piece or something. But if you're on an extreme budget, yeah, just get a pair of like Sennheiser HD 280s or something like that, like $100. That's what I would do. Headphones over home theater speakers any day. What are some of the key differences between mixing a song for YouTube and mixing for, say, an album? Well, with an album, there's multiple people involved. There are many people involved in mixing an album. And what I mean by that is when you mix it, you know, it has to get approved and it has to get past the band, the rest of the band, and maybe a record label or management or something like that. But there's always multiple people involved in deciding if a mix is done. Whereas YouTube, I'm just mixing for me, and I say when it's done. And another key difference is with YouTube, I try a lot of things. My mixes kind of vary, although a lot of people complain that all my mixes sound the same, but I do try a lot of different stuff just because I don't have to care that much. I mean, I'm not putting out a record, it's a YouTube video. So I do take more chances for the YouTube songs than I would an actual album. That and budget and recording time and mix time and all sorts of stuff. I mean, it really couldn't be more different, but there are a lot of similarities, I suppose. How did you become more natural on camera? Did you practice? Because 2 years ago, you looked uncomfortable. Well, thank you. Really, all I did was read up on public speaking and watched a lot of videos on public speaking, because the difference is when you're talking to people and when you are actually publicly speaking, you are getting feedback from the audience. Whereas YouTube, you're nothing. I'm staring in to a camera and it's giving me no feedback. So you kind of have to make up that feedback on your own, and you do learn it over time. That's why, you know, in the early days of this channel, you don't know, there's nothing to react to. So you just kind of, because you're busy thinking about what to say next and you're worried about being stale, which makes you stale and that kind of a thing. So, I don't know, it's just a learned skill, I suppose, but thank you for noting the differences in how I am on camera versus 2 years ago. I wasn't that bad 2 years ago. I was probably that bad 2 years ago, but still, yeah, just practice and reading up on stuff. And now, Fluff reads a tweet. Why do blind people hate skydiving? It scares the hell out of their dogs. My suggestion to you this week is to check out the new album, The Spark That Moves, from the homies, the Cancer Bats. Good friends of mine, they kind of surprise dropped their new album that they recorded in secret back at the beginning of the year. And it's good. It's classic Cancer Bats. It's kind of a mix between Hail Destroyer and like Dead Set on Living, I would say. But it's definitely the start of like the next decade of Cancer Bats. They've looked back to the last decade, their first decade in existence. All right, that's awesome. Let's celebrate that. Also, let's incorporate some new stuff and new songwriting, better songwriting into this new album. It's great. Nasty, nasty riffs. Scott is just a master riffsman, and the rest of the band are just incredible as well. All the big links down below in the description. You've been wonderful. I've been Fluff. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you next time.